Hi, this is Jim Brisson here with part three of three videos about organizational structure and its effects on your ability to be agile. So let's get started. Now in part one, I discussed what is typically wrong with our large organizational structures. And in part two, I described a much happier place, describing some better organizational structures. So now in part three, I'm going to talk a little bit of sociology and then describe the inverse Conway maneuver and talk about steps to change your organization. So let's jump right into the sociology. Now, I'm not a sociologist, and I'm not pretending to be. There are three basic methods of coordination. Autonomy, which yields fast decisions and more flexibility. Hierarchical, where management need perhaps multiple levels coordinate, so communication and decision-making is slow. And standardization, where rules and phase gates and processes dictate how coordination occurs. So three types of coordination: autonomous, hierarchical, and standardized. Where we are making decisions that affect many, and we can make them slowly, then hierarchical coordination can be appropriate. But most of the time, we want to empower teams making quick decisions based on the detailed knowledge available to them, so they're high-quality decisions. So mostly, we want autonomy. So there are four key attributes of organizational structure: span of control, centralization of decision making, formalization, that is the rules and processes that are involved, and departmentalization, how departments are organized. And we'll talk about functional, project, and matrixed department organizations. Narrow span of control indicates that fewer employees are controlled by one manager. In this example, Green Girl can exercise more control and more interference because she manages fewer people than does Purple Guy. And more autonomous organizations have wider span of control. Centralization refers to how decisions are made. Green Girl makes the decisions for her team, so authority and decision-making is centralized. At the other extreme, an autonomous organization makes decisions for themselves. For knowledge workers, as mentioned previously, decentralized autonomous decision-making is preferable. Centralized decisions may be preferable when they can be made more slowly and will likely have a wide impact. Now, formalization is the extent to which processes, rules, and plans are created and monitored. Now, that's versus allowing groups to self-manage. And that whole discussion reminds us of Dunbar's number and how smaller organizations and less distance will help us get by with less rules, planning, and meetings. So departments can be organized by the function that team members provide. So teams of developers are in departments separate from those of function testers and so on. Now in a project structure, you might have a portfolio of products where each product has one or more projects and multiple teams work on projects. Now, a matrix organization, I'm going to talk about a big matrix first. A matrix organization tries to have both a functional and project flavor. And the classic way to do this is to have a project manager with project participants organized functionally. And perhaps you'll have the upper part of the project hierarchy as well. So the classic matrix gave most people multiple managers. And clearly, that's not going to diminish meetings or communication. Also, this structure did nothing to minimize distance and ignored Dunbar's number. So, what we want is a matrix scheme that does minimize distance. We want communication within the team, or at least within the tribe. So we want goals, help, expertise, dependencies, all of our reasons to communicate within a small organization so that we can get that communication done in a trusting relationship with minimal overhead. So to summarize the four attributes of organizational structure, we want wider span of control since we'll need less management. We want decentralization, so decisions can be made at the lowest level. We want informality, few rules, and we want matrix within the team with essentially a project and functional structure all within one team if we can do that. Now, Dan Pink has a great YouTube video on motivation. I'll put a link in the comments for this video. Now, assuming we have enough to meet our basic needs, he says that further motivation has three key elements. Autonomy, we want to have the control to be able to change our work processes for the better. Mastery, we naturally want to get better at work, hobbies, etc. I mean, why are you watching this video? So we want a work environment that supports mastery of our job. And purpose, we want to understand goals so that we can use our knowledge, intelligence, and mastery to achieve them, which gives us a lot of job satisfaction. Now notice that more money, raises, bonuses, and awards are notably absent from this list. So turning all that I just talked about around, what are some smells that should concern you? Well, a small span of control, because that's going to yield tighter hierarchical control. Lots of rules, processes, and guidelines, obviously. That indicates less autonomy. A push for standardization, again, indicates low autonomy. Functional or project teams, that's just going in the wrong direction of organization. Centralized power, we want empowered teams. If you see project managers and PMOs, that means that extra management seems to be needed, so our organizational structure is not doing us any favors. We have too much communication outside of Dunbar's number and so on. When we see low morale and low motivation, then teams are lacking autonomy and clear goals and leading to lower morale. So overall, we want to minimize distance to dependencies, communication, decisions, goals, and so on, so that we can have informal communication and use relationships rather than rules and make decisions quickly. So in sociology terms, if you want to be agile, you want decentralized decision-making, informality with few rules and processes, a minimal matrix structure with autonomous teams that continually focus on mastery and where team members clearly understand the goals. Now, Conway's law says that organizations that design systems will produce designs that are copies of the communication structures of those organizations. So basically, the architecture of the system will mirror the organizational structure. And the clear example that I've heard pretty often is that if you have three departments work on a compiler, you're going to end up with a three-phase compiler. So let's turn Conway's law on its head. We started in part one by describing an organizational structure based on product line engineering architecture that resulted in too many dependencies, presenting monstrous problems for an agile organization. Then in parts two and three, we described a better solution. Now, if we now change the organizational structure, Conway's law suggests that the architecture will, over time, reflect the new organizational structure. And that's exactly what I mean by the inverse Conway maneuver. If we design our structure well, this should be a good result, minimizing dependencies and communication needs. Now, deciding on the value streams that form the basis for tribal organization and so on is a process that I just think is beyond the scope of discussion here. Please contact me if you'd like any help with this. It's what I do. So let's now summarize the basic concepts for organizational change. We want to first create communities of practice and guilds, helping mastery, moving to a learning organization. We want to implement cross-functional, cross-domain teams to greatly limit the distance of communication and to localize decisions. We want to have clear and persistent goals for the teams and the tribes. And we want to introduce new tribes for new initiatives. If they're successful, new requirements and defects will come in, so those tribes will often persist. And we'll need to continually tune to keep the organizational structures effective. We'll want to track dependencies and communication, etc., so that we'll have real metrics to know when we need to make adjustments to the organizational structure and maximize relationships over rules. Okay, the summary. Though organizational structure is just one aspect of Agile, I hope I've convinced you Dunbar's number and organizational structure are pretty darn important. you need to create communities of practice and a learning organization. You want to maximize autonomy and empower teams. You want to use cross-functional, cross-domain teams enabling decision-making at the lowest level and have very clear and well-understood goals. This is Jim Brisson. Thanks so much for watching. I hope you stuck with me on all three videos. If you want to talk about any of this, I'd love to discuss it with you. My email address is on any page of this presentation. Okay, thanks for watching. Bye.